This is Aviary Paragraph. We're sponsored by viewers like you, as well as Pacific Thought Feuds and Borzoi Books. Please, welcome yourself to enjoy this fine show, and have yourself a good day now. Thank you so much for tuning in. All right, see you later. Greetings, welcome. Of course, I am Zan Mars. It is Monday the 14th, December 2015, here in our fine studio on this holiest of years, 2015, and you are listening to Aviary Paragraph. We have a suitable podcast for you today, and I am sitting next to one of the most, what I'd like to think may be, the most vigorous birders I know, or would like to know, Martin Salinas.
A birder's hello to you, Zan.
And a birder's hello right back to you, Martin. Now, we had a... funny thing happened last time we were trying to record this famous show, unfortunately we ran into a few microphone technical difficulties last time. Now, you remember this?
Oh, I couldn't forget it.
It's my pleasure and my privilege to introduce also our third guest on the show today. Our first guest. His name is Tim Leque. He was with us here last time on the show. It was a very interesting exploration of kind of Tim. Hello.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you here. I gotta tell you that.
Yes, second time.
Second time's a charm, you know. Our podcast today, like I said, is gonna be very appropriate for the subject matter, and that we are both reviewing the Bucephala Albeola, and we are talking to, we're talking about the Bufflehead on this episode. See, it's kind of funny there. I almost said I was talking to the Bufflehead, but we all know that here, as members of our birding community, we do discuss the Bufflehead.
We like to talk about the Bufflehead.
But we don't like to talk to the Bufflehead. Sometimes we make calls to the Bufflehead, but we don't talk to the birds. Or have you ever talked to the birds?
I've actually found myself a few times while I'm birding solo. Every once in a while I'm looking at the birds. I'll maybe say, come a little closer, come a little closer. Talking to the birds a little bit there.
So do you like, you talk to the birds most times you're out on the field birding?
Yeah, when I'm out in the field birding, that's the time that I'm talking to the birds if it happens.
Why do you talk to the birds?
That's a good question, Zan. I'd say that I'd probably have to do a
little
introspection.
Okay, yeah, and so, Tim, why do you ever talk to the birds?
Yeah, kind of similar to what...
Really, you guys are out in the field a lot, I reckon, from this diatribe you've both gone on here.
Yeah, you know, it makes them come closer if you ask them to.
So, we have a very, very special segment we would like to introduce today, the Birders Weather segment on Aviary Paragraph.
Weatherman, would you send me a rainy day? It suits my mood, 'cause my whole world just turned gray. Weatherman, don't you dare let the sun shine like the day when I lost that love of mine. I remember the time the day brought rain like you said it would, and I stayed home like I knew I should. But the sun came out and she went out. I never thought she could. Every man needs a someone to sit beside and keep him warm when the cold wind blows outside. I remember the time. The sun came out and she went out. I never thought she could. Weatherman, would you send me a rainy day? It suits my mood, 'cause my whole world just turned gray yesterday.
Martin, hit it.
All right, this is for all the birders out there that are wondering what the best time is going to be for them to go out and find those birds. So this week, what our forecast is looking like.
I'm not sure what our forecast is looking like, I got to tell you, Martin, and I'm really interested to find out.
Yes, so what our forecast is looking like this week is if you get out there, I would highly recommend going.
And early. we hope that you do get out there. It doesn't matter what the weather is.
If you get out there, take off early in the morning. This time of year, as the fog lifts, is a fantastic time to go out and spot some of those golden crown and ruby crown kinglets. They might be moving in mixed flocks. Brown creepers could be mixed in, black-capped chickadees. If you're lucky, you might even see some of those rare warblers that haven't quite migrated. I've heard some sightings of here in Thurston County, a common yellowthroat staying here all the way into December.
You see a lot of starlings out there right now?
Wish I could say no, but unfortunately, yes.
No. So, we did say before that we are doing this here on the Bufflehead. We do enjoy talking about the Bufflehead. We do like speaking about the Bufflehead. The oldest Bufflehead known to exist, I gotta tell you here, was 18 years old. So that is kind of an uproarious age to reach, I'd say. What's your opinion on this? Now, that's an 18-year-old Bufflehead? That's kind of a larger bird, don't you think?
Now, for a Bufflehead, that's pretty old, but I do have to kind of chime in here with my two cents. We got Wisdom, the albatross, over 60 years old, and this bird continues to live.
So, Tim, now, have you seen any of older birds ever in your line of work?
Yeah, we got a streak-torn lark on Fort Lewis that we banded. All his bands have fallen off except for one little pink band, so we call him Pinky, and he's been around for at least six or seven seasons.
Sorry, I gotta contain myself over here.
Yeah, I know, a lot of successful clutches from him. He's a fit individual.
A clutch bird.
I definitely hope that Pinky continues to be seen. I hope someday I get a chance to see Pinky.
I hope so too.
Yeah, so we're going to get a little bit more into the Bufflehead a little later in the show. We got a couple of great segments for you here today. We're going to talk about birds. We're going to talk about technology. We're going to talk about everything that the birder, you know, wants to talk about. But first, we got to intro the show here with what I introduced a little bit last show. This is a haiku for you. This is on Heron's haiku. Martin, could you give that to us?
Bufflehead takes off, black and white with yellow eye, swift beauty in flight. Now, I'm actually going to take a little objection to my own haiku. Can I do that, Zan?
Yeah, you know, I did last week, so I think I'll allow that this time as well.
I'm going to go ahead and repeat the second line for our listeners in case they didn't catch it. Hopefully some of the birders out there, I bet you caught this. Second line, once again, black and white. Sounds like a Bufflehead.
Mm-hmm.
But let's pay attention to this last few syllables. With yellow eye. I'm going to go ahead and ask you guys, open your field guides. Look in there. I'm not seeing any Bufflehead with yellow
eye. I'm pulling up a Bufflehead on the screen right now. Tim, could you tell me what color that eye is?
It's black.
Yeah, it does. So somebody here obviously wasn't minding their P's or their Q's.
I'm going to say they're a poet, not a birder.
Yeah, well, you always got to, that's the one thing you got to look out for is poets versus birders. Who knows? So, I have one other bone kind of to pick with you here on the show, quite frankly, Martin. I got this bone. I gotta pick it. I hate to be frank, but I truly do have to pick this bone. I do have this bone to pick with you. So, earlier in the show, I called the show a podcast. So, I think we could actually start calling the show, what I'd like to call it, is a birdcast.
And whoa.
Come on. Just give me a second here.
All right.
Don't walk all over me, okay? Come on. All right. I think we should actually start calling the show, calling it a birdcast. And I know you brought this up with me earlier, so I was wondering how you felt about that.
Yeah, you know, the reason I brought this up with you earlier is because a birdcast is already something in existence very different from our show. A birdcast is something that birders actually do already. They use the tools of meteorologists to actually see the nocturnally migrating birds, be it waterfowl in the fall and winter, or the neotropical songbirds of the spring and summer. Now, meteorologists oftentimes can use their tools to see cloud cover, even at night. So these are radar satellite type tools. But on a clear night, meteorologists' tools can actually be used to detect the presence of hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of migrating birds. They show up like clouds.
It's kind of funny that you're talking about that. It kind of reminds me a little bit of the last segment we just did actually on this show, which is our third show. It was Birders Weather. That segment, maybe we should start calling that segment Birdcast.
It is a little bit of a bird cast.
Which is interesting kind of throwback. It's sort of like a 70s thing. Tim, do you kind of see what I'm saying there with that?
Yeah, I can see that.
Okay, that's great, man. so I do enjoy birds, but I will say that doesn't mean I don't enjoy fine foods as well. So that is why I must say that this is our segment for which bird is for dinner. In this segment, we say that although we do not say you have to eat birds, particularly chicken, although I know everybody eats chicken out there, but also other birds, we also wish that you do not eat these animals. Now, I went out to dinner with a very controversial dish. So this dish is foie gras.
Foie gras?
Foie gras. Now, foie gras, I did do my research on this. It's a fatty liver from a duck, force-fed. Could be you're having a little bit of a Butterworth duck, like the one we're talking about today, Bufflehead duck liver, and with your foie gras. It's a force-fed duck, but is it bad? Martin Salinas has more on this here on Aviary Paragraph.
Now, I gotta tell you, Zan, my stomach is just churning at the thought of foie gras. Now, this is a food that in California, I understand, is actually outlawed because it's viewed as highly unethical.
Well, I got a bone to pick with you on this one. California, it is outlawed, so they don't actually eat that there.
Yeah, and I think maybe California is leading the way on this one. This just seems like...
California syndrome.
California syndrome. Could you tell us a little bit?
San Francisco syndrome. And you got a lot of tech people moving in. Now, although foie gras is the result of a force-fed duck, I will also retaliate with the point that it is not necessarily a dish served by force-feeding. Using the article, "Can Foie Gras Ever Be Ethical?" by Trevor Baker, I aim to account for the unreasonable disgust which foie gras has popularized in our birding community. He says, quote-unquote, "If a Disney film about a farm came to life, it might look a bit like Sousa's, standing in the middle of his flock of geese, holding out a bag of mace, ruddy a cheek, and with slick back, dark hair. He's ever bit the kindly farmer. Around him, there were fig and olive trees, and Spanish oaks heavily with acorns. Just down the hill is a whitewashed farmhouse, and stretching into the distance are the green hills of Spain's western hinterland." Like Trevor Baker was saying in that quote, I should point out that the article does discuss Sousa, who is generally seen as a good guy. He makes the ethical foie gras. That's Sousa foie gras. We're friends if you don't remember this, our friends at Radiolab actually covered this a little while ago, the Sousa foie gras syndrome. He gets those ducks to come in, and of course they're gonna eat. And if they're not domesticated, he's gonna get these ducks to eat themselves to death.
Yeah, you know, Zan, I'd have to look a little bit more into it myself, but I'm gonna have to say that my own viewpoints aren't quite shifted from that article.
Tim, now, can you counter him on that?
As far as foie gras goes, for me, you wouldn't really have to force me to feed on that, eat myself to death on the foie gras.
There would be a certain irony to that.
Right. I guess that is kind of funny.
A patron goes into a restaurant and eats so much foie gras.
I didn't actually think about that.
That his liver explodes.
This is why I love this show. I gotta tell you, this is why I love this show. I love making this show. So, Lastly, I would like to discuss a little game known as Spotter's Sound. Everyone knows this game, of course, but Tim, I'd love you to intro this segment, please.
Spotter's Sound, the game
we're about to play.
Yeah, that it's
played last week.
It's a great game, you know. I had a great time last
time. Could you please explain the game to the listening audience?
Yeah, so we're going to hear three different sounds.
Sound number one is?
I don't remember.
I see.
A bird noise.
Sound number two?
Yeah.
Is a bird noise and then another noise.
Okay.
And sound number three?
Another noise and then a bird noise.
Oh. Okay, so
you know, in my defense, on the previous
you were the loser on the show.
I lost, but in my defense, I was the phone-in caller and could not hear the sounds very well.
That's true. I didn't think about that. We actually haven't experienced a lot of technical difficulties on the show. Tim, thanks for reminding me about that. Thank you.
I accept both of your apologies.
That's nice of you. Okay, so Spotter Sound, here we go with sound number one on Spotter Sound.
Now, what's the cue?
This is just a bird sound, and we're playing this sound live on Spotter Sound. We got any guesses on that? Who, say beep beep if you know.
Beep beep.
Alright. Martin jumped on that one. What do you think we got here, Martin?
So just based on the cadence of that call, I'm going to go with something in the corvid family. I'm going to go with a blue jay.
I don't even know how you got that. That's unbelievable to me. You know, this is why I bring him on the show. You know, I was talking about how vigorous you were before, and I gotta tell you, this guy's more vigorous than vinegar. Alright, we got sound number two on Spotter Sound. And this sound is a bird sound, and it's also another sound on Spotter Sound. Okay, we got Tim on this one.
And there was a chickadee, a brewer's blackbird, and a dog.
Wow, that was really close. I gotta tell you, do you have any guesses on this one, Martin?
Yeah, you know, I could definitely hear that chickadee giving its really distinctive call.
Right.
But other than that, I actually couldn't pick out the other noises.
You know, our judges do say that is that might be a dog. So we're going to give that to you on the show. We're feeling a little lenient. You had explained about your previous sort of fallacies that you faced on Spotter Sound. And so we're going to give this one to you. We tied it up here on Spotter Sound. So this is best 2 out of 3, as all Spotter Sounds are. And of course, we end this with what I'd like to call just a sound, here on Spotter Sound.
Sounded like a little swine to me.
Okay, Martin, did you have anything on that one?
I didn't.
Okay, so... with both of them saying it's a swine, that ties us up here on Spotter's Sound. We will have to take a tie on this show here on Aviary Paragraph on Spotter's Sound. That was Spotter's Sound. And so we move on with that to our next segment of the show. This is a new one here. It's one where we got three stories on birding, with one of them being true. It's called Birder's Fib.
You know, I know you had some stories prepared. We had talked about that before, but yeah. I actually have some stories that I'm going to share. So, Tim, the way this segment of our show works is I will be sharing with you three stories. One of them is true. The other two are false. So... I'm going to go ahead and have you listen to these stories, and then we'll see if you can tell me which are true and which are false. You think you can do it, Tim?
Give it a whirl.
All right, so for story one.
This is, of course, our most famous segment, Birder's Fib, with Martin Salinas speaking for us on these stories here.
Story?
Aviary Paragraph.
I got an e-bird and knew immediately that I was going to chase this code 5. Grabbing my binos, the 85mm capture gear, and dud, I headed south on 101. Reports were that it was in basic plume, but it could just as easily be a juvie. Arriving, I saw there were other chasers, county claimers, big ear birders, and others. No bird. It'd flown. We all dipped. No dance. Huh? What is he talking about? Okay, I've been asked this many times lately to explain what this jargon means. So, we'll do a one more time, okay? Birdwatcher. Hey, Martha, while you're at the co-op, would you pick up another sack of bird seed for the chickadees? These are bird watchers. People who spend time watching birds come to feeders, or drive down to Three Crabs and park to watch seagulls or geese. Wonderful people, curious people, people who just like to watch birds. Birder, a birder, birds. This means that she has a pair of good binos, a tripod sporting a scope, and bird books scattered on the front seat of her vehicle at all times. More than likely, she also has a digital camera with a 70 to 400 millimeter lens attached, and in her pocket a smartphone with all the latest apps for bird calls, songs, and ID pictures. She reads tweeters first thing when she opens her computer every morning, checks the ABA, runs through Birder's dashboard, birds in her local area, county, state, North America, and maybe even the world. She keeps lists of birds she's seen, and she can tell a fall juvie short-billed dowitcher from a long-billed dowitcher just by the seat of her pants. That was story number one.
Sounds like you're speaking, you know, the way that they're saying is all Greek to me. And, you know, I gotta say, it sounds like they're speaking French on there. Some sort of foreign language. I mean, that's gotta be false.
All right, are you ready for story number 210?
I'm ready.
I usually go towards the edge of town to bird, but on Sunday I pedaled to the interior city limits to hit two scenic destinations, a water treatment plant and a cemetery. Jumping on the River Greenway downtown, the first interesting bird I noticed were a few northern shovelers. I think this is the first time I've ever seen them in their bright orange legs. Arriving at the water treatment plant, the only other bird of note was a lone horned grebe, bobbing way out on the terminal ponds. I wouldn't have bothered to post this shot except for a pretty good picture. With the waterfowl mostly a bust, I headed back through downtown to visit a sparsely birded but occasionally great Lindenwood Cemetery. It was my first visit of the year, and my mission was Bufflehead. I came up totally empty, unless you count mallards. Although I was able to acquaint myself with some of the more common birds around, including a pair of blue jays foraging for acorns near the water's edge next to some headstones. Now, the bufflehead reported from Thanksgiving Day was not seen, but here's where the story gets funny. I pedaled into the middle of the cemetery, which was almost completely deserted. I ignored the one single car there and ate a hasty peanut butter sandwich while listening for bufflehead calls. When I was done eating, I pulled out my phone to play a recording of a bufflehead, hoping to get really lucky. Within 10 seconds, the door to the car flew open and a gentleman stepped out, calling with some hesitation, "Are you birding?" My answer? Yes. His reply? "Did you just play a tape?" My reply? Yes. He continued, "Of a bufflehead?" My response? "Now on guard." Yes. I was mostly playing the recording for my own education, since I have never heard nor actually seen a BUFF. But this guy was totally not expecting anyone else to be there birding, let alone birding on a bike. So he was about through the roof when he was thinking he had found the bird. Oops, disclaimer. I don't use playback very often, but have been known to on occasion. In the end, he asked me to play it again in the off chance it would attract the bird, plus one for cool other birders. And that was story number two, Jen.
I'm gonna say that is false, because she said she'd never seen a bufflehead before.
This is a case of agree to disagree with you, Tim, here. I picture myself in the birder's
feet. Alright, we got story number three coming up. Are you ready, Zan?
Oh, hell yeah.
Are you ready, Tim?
Oh, I'm ready.
11:59 p.m. Standing there waiting, Tika had the watch. Now, midnight. We stood there listening. Where was there? On the bluff, overlooking Cape Alava's beach at Ozette. There was no moon. The sky was clear. A breeze came in off the ocean. But it was black enough that I couldn't see Hank standing 20 feet away. There! Pointing. I knew he was pointing. He always pointed. 12:01 a.m. Short-billed dowitchers, talking skyward, flying north. Bird one was tallied. That was unexpected. The barred owl, we'd expect, called back from the woods. Another answered, "Time to move!" With Tika as clock watcher and a schedule to keep, we started walking.
I gotta tell you, Martin, we gotta shorten these stories up for this segment. This is a very long story, and these have all been very long stories. Quite frankly, I don't know, you know. I mean, I'm the first guy, I believe all stories need to be long, but these stories are just too dang long. If I'm gonna be honest with you. You know, you see what I mean, right?
I'm just trying to do the segment, Zan.
Well, this is just a little revision. Call me your editor here on Aviary Paragraph.
That was Birdage Fib. We gotta tell you, we don't always get it right here at Aviary Paragraph. I think that might have been a case where we actually got it wrong. We don't always get it correct over here. So, that will be the last time Birdage Fib is on the show. And for any fans of Birdage Fib, I'm afraid that's going to be that. This one here is called Back to Bufflehead. We're going back to Bufflehead to talk more about our bird of the week. Just as a little intro to this segment, we're going to just kind of chat Bufflehead for a bit. We will be talking all Bufflehead, only Bufflehead, 24/7, for at least the next 5 minutes or so. So, here we are with our Bufflehead talk. So, I heard this. This is a very interesting one I got online. It's that the Bufflehead's call, it's regards the onomatopoeia of the Bufflehead call. It's a wee-oo-wee-oo, a wee-oo-wee-oo. That's a wee-oo-wee-oo, wee-oo-wee-oo. Call actually was a Maori saying. That's very interesting, actually.
Like New Zealand.
As in New Zealand, the Maori people, yeah.
They well, came up with that's interesting to me, Zan.
Why is that?
Well, the bufflehead is a North American species of waterfowl, not one found in New Zealand.
Was that getting it wrong 2.0? So the bufflehead, in your experience, I know that you know a little bit more about that bird.
Yeah, I've spotted many bufflehead.
And what do you think when you spotted them?
You know, I just love the way they dive under the water and then pop back up, and I love the way the males can just lift their crests when they're doing a mating display to really show you why they have that name, Bufflehead.
Any ideas on conservation or environment or anything like that?
You know, as far as conservation and environment...
I know these little guys like grubs, eating grub.
Yeah, these little guys like to eat a lot. I'd say the biggest threat they have is that they are a bay duck. They like to come in really close to the shoreline to feed. That also happens to be where hunters are. Now, this is a species that is permitted to hunt. And I think that they're a little more susceptible than many of the other waterfowl species that might use more open water habitats.
Gotcha. Now, I was actually at the deli earlier today, and I was talking to somebody in line, and they were telling me... I was telling a little bit about the show, and they had mentioned to me that actually they talk about the flicker, the association of a flicker to the bufflehead, and there's like a lot of different types of flickers.
Yeah, I think you're talking about the red-shafted flicker and the yellow-shafted flicker. Now, for some of our listeners out there, the flicker is actually a small woodpecker. You might see it in your yard. Diet consists primarily of ants, and the flicker, the red-shafted and the yellow-shafted flicker, actually have the shaft or the raucous of their feathers is the color in their name.
But wait, Martin. What's that got to do with the bufflehead?
Funny you should ask, Zan. The bufflehead, one of the smallest species of North American waterfowl, is actually so small because part of its evolution is that it uses the flicker's cavities in trees to nest. It's the only waterfowl species that can fit inside of a flicker nest cavity.
Gotcha.
Martin, have you ever had the privilege of witnessing a bufflehead feeding frenzy?
I have, and what a sight.
Now, wait a minute here. Did you say feeding friendly?
No, feeding frenzy.
Oh, frenzy. Okay. Now, what's that all about?
This is I witnessed in Capitol Lake in Olympia, walking along, and I notice, something in the water. Okay. I take a look. and there's dozens and dozens and dozens of bufflehead just diving down, coming back up, and eating who knows what. But there is about, you know, 50 bufflehead all in one place and creating just a bubbling stew of, you know, butterball.
Now, see, this is really one of those, another one of those eating the snake's tail moments. Martin, actually, we was talking about fishing or something like that. This one, we got another eating the snake eats its tail. It's interesting, we were just talking about the misplacement of the Maori name Wiu-Wiu. That's a Maori name. Now, in the Olympic Capital Lake over here in Olympia, there is a New Zealand snail in the water there. And this New Zealand snail actually is going to be getting on all those buffleheads and going to be transported to other ponds and tributaries throughout the U.S., thus spreading New Zealand snails, fortunately for us, actually throughout the great state of Pacific Northwest.
And I think what we can all hope, and certainly is likely, is that those New Zealand snails that might find their way tucked up into the feathers of the bufflehead could actually die off. Say the bufflehead is using that Capital Lake infested with that invasive snail, moves over to the saltwater. That snail cannot survive the saltwater. So as soon as it touches that saltwater and that snail absorbs that salt, it would kill the snail off. So provided that the bufflehead at some point stops on saltwater before...
Stops on, it means they turn very quickly. So, now, do you have anything to say about these snails? Do you ever, when you're disturbing wildlife communities out there and your environmental practices, Tim, I know you start fires around. Do you ever burn these snails or anything like that?
We don't burn the snails, mainly because they're aquatic species and, you know, by nature, water extinguishes fire.
So essentially, that would be sort of the method to your madness. That's the method side. I know you enjoy the madness side, so you don't actually particularly enjoy not burning these snails, you'd say.
You know, the burning really has nothing to do with the snails, to be honest. But, you know, when doing any sort of aquatic work in and out of the river, it's important to remember to wash your boat, wash your boots, wash any waders or fishing gear you use in a New Zealand snail infested water body, because, you know, you move on to another area, you could very easily transport those snails. So
you don't want to be the bufflehead that spread that snail.
You don't want to be the bufflehead. And let me tell you, the fish and wildlife, they're, you know,
I'm pointing my finger at you because I have one other thing to say, Zan, and that is bufflehead.
Wow, see, now, if you could only sort of see inside our studio right now, kind of the expression on Martin's face when he says that, you can tell the sort of consternation that he has over a subject like the bufflehead. It's incredible when you see the focus on this guy's face. I mean, if you're talking about a focused birder, this guy, he's got more vigor than vinegar. I love this guy. That's why I love doing this show with him. And let me tell you, Tim, I got to re-engage you here. We also love having you on the show. And with
it's a pleasure to be here, Zan.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you there, buddy.
It's a beautiful studio.
Thank you so much for that. We do actually bring up as our next point with that. That's one of the many different communication strategies I'm using. I'm in a book I've been reading a little bit about. Basically, I've been reading this nonviolent communication book. It's a second edition written by Marshall B. Rosenberg, PhD. I think we all know that guy. He's a bit of an egghead over there.
I mean, that's great stuff.
That's a hot, that's those are, really well, we all stuff. Know that those are hot button issues. So for our last segment, this is a very serious segment. I gotta tell you, this segment really, honestly, you gotta take this one seriously. It comes to us from wildbirds.com. We got the ultimate techno birder and his gadgets, Peter W. Thayer. Huge bona fide birder. We're reviewing a little bit of a ex officio. Are you talking about? Does that sound right to you, Martin?
Ex officio, it's some gear I've used before.
You have used ex officio? What type of gear by ex officio have you used?
Pants.
Well, we aren't talking about pants today. I gotta say, we're talking about vests. Here we have, from bazillions.com, the reviews of Ex Officio's Buzz Off Insect Shield Vest. That's the ultralight nylon. Let's see here. We have Adventure Girl. She writes, used for African safari in Tanzania. Very comfortable and protective. She loved it. Up the River from Ohio. He said he needed a lightweight vest. He loved that about it. It was so light. Dr. Dye, he just walks a dog with it. So, I mean, this tells you all about the vest here. You don't have to wear it just to bird. You can walk the dog. You can You can buzz your uncle, whatever you want to do.
Get
the groceries. It really works. Anna Glover in the studio right now. She's our famous producer. Anna, what do you think about Tim as a guest? I gotta ask.
I think it's a pretty alright choice.
Yeah. So with your overview of the first three episodes, do you think your producing career could hit a height as high as it has?
Yeah, I mean, as long as I got money going on it, it's fine.
You feel like you could soar like a hawk?
Well, it's interesting that Martin says that this is when his vigor gets out of line. And I gotta tell you, he has gotten out of line. Now, Martin, I think that's an interesting point you say. Now, do you ever feel like kind of like a bird sometimes when you're in a studio? Producer, do you kind of do that at all?
Like method producing?
Method producing?
I'd say so.
If you asked me how I would describe myself as a guest, I would say great.
I just gotta chime in here. We got a couple of birders in the studio.
We do.
We got a couple people who love to talk about all things birds. But behind it all, we got a great producer. I mean, we couldn't be luckier with
our
producer.
We could not be luckier. I love that. Here, give me a high five.
Anna Glover
also, high five. There we go. Anna, I know she actually birds 7 to 8 times a week. Did you catch anything today on your latest walk?
Yeah, I did. I saw
Pied-billed grebe, or...
Yeah, I think I saw a warbler.
A warbler.
Yeah.
Those are considerably rare, to my understanding.
This time of year. Oh, most
yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, also...
That's a very rare spot, actually.
It might have been a tennis ball. I don't know.
Okay, all right. I got you. Yeah. Here we go again. This is why we have fun on this show, and we love to bring it to you viewers out there. So, the park hopper without a purse from Clement, Florida, he says it's exactly what he needed. He likes, he went to Disney World with it. This is just the type of stuff I'm saying. Now, Martin, you're an ultralight backpacker. You love, he's kind of got an interesting style when it comes to the ultralight scene.
Actually out on the west coast of the Olympic Peninsula here in Washington, trying to find some of those pelagic birds that time of year with the good wind coming in from the coast tend to move in closer to the shoreline where you can see them with your binocs.
Okay. Well, thanks from us over here at Aviary Paragraph.
Get out there and go bird.
Thank you for having me on.
I gotta
Thank
tell you.
You,
dude, it's been a pleasure. I'm sorry about my outburst earlier. Again, I don't apologize.
And this is your number 2 producer and lover.
And we'll sign off to you now on Aviary Paragraph.
I used to feel oh so bad.